Good morning. Welcome to Trinity on this beautiful Sunday morning. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Almighty God, unto whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of thy Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love thee and worthily magnify thy holy name through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you.
And with our spirit.
Let us pray. O God, the strength of all those who put their trust in thee, mercifully accept our prayers, and because through the weakness of our mortal nature, we can do no good thing without thee, grant us the help of thy grace, that in keeping thy commandments we may please thee both in will and deed, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who liveth and reigneth with thee in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated.
A reading from the book of the prophet Jeremiah. Thus says the Lord, cursed are those who trust in mere mortals and make mere flesh their strength, whose hearts turn away from the Lord. They shall be like a shrub in the desert, and shall not see when relief comes. They shall live in the parched places in the wilderness, in an uninhabited salt land. Blessed are those who trust in the Lord, whose trust is the Lord. They shall be like a tree planted by water, sending out its roots by the stream. It shall not fear when heat comes, and its leaves shall stay green. In the year of drought it is not anxious, and it does not cease to bear fruit. The heart is devious above all else. It is perverse. Who can understand it? I, the Lord, test the mind and search the heart, to give to all according to their ways, according to their fruit of their doings. The word of the Lord.
Thank you.
reading from Paul's first letter to the church in Corinth. Now, if Christ is proclaimed as raised from the dead, how can some of you say there is no resurrection of the dead? If there is no resurrection of the dead, then Christ has not been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, then our proclamation has been in vain, and your faith has been in vain. We are even found to be misrepresenting God, because we testified of God that he raised Christ, whom he did not raise, if it is true that the dead are not raised. For if the dead are not raised, then Christ has not been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, your faith is futile, and you are still in your sins. Then those also who have died in Christ have perished. If for this life only we have hoped in Christ, we are of all people most to be pitied. But in fact, Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have died. The word of the Lord.
The Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Luke. Jesus came down with the 12 apostles and stood on a level place with a great crowd of his disciples and a great multitude of people from all Judea, Jerusalem, and the coast of Tyre and Sidon. They had come to hear him and to be healed of their diseases. And those who were troubled with unclean spirits were cured. And in all the crowd were trying to touch him, for power came out from him and he healed all of them. Then he looked up at the disciples and said, "Blessed are you who are poor, for yours is the kingdom of God. Blessed are you who are hungry now, for you will be filled. Blessed are you who weep now, for you will laugh. Blessed are you when people hate you, and when they exclude you, revile you, and defame you on account of the Son of Man. Rejoice in that day and leap for joy, for surely your reward is great in heaven. For that is what their ancestors did to the prophets. But woe to you who are rich, for you have received your consolation. Woe to you who are full now, for you will be hungry. Woe to you who are laughing now, for you will mourn and weep. Woe to you when all speak well of you, for that is what their ancestors did to the false prophets." The Gospel of the Lord.
Thank you. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please be seated. Well, good morning, everyone. As Mother Cheryl said, it is a gorgeous, glorious Sunday. I wanted to start by asking you all a question. How many of you all have had a chance at some point, it doesn't have to be recent, but at some point have had a chance to get away to the mountains? How many people here have been to the mountains? So we got a lot of people here who have been to the mountains. Was that recent? Like, did folks get away recently? You know, like when we've been dealing, you know, for the last couple of years with this pandemic that has been gripping us. I know that my spouse and I kind of took a look at where we could go on a vacation last summer, and we thought to ourselves, well, one place we could probably escape to is the mountains, spend some time up there. It's outdoors, we could do some hiking, and when we came off the mountain, when we had a chance to actually get our exercise in and then come back down to town, there were a lot of restaurants that had tables outside, so you could go and you could actually dine in the outdoors, and that felt like it was going to be a relatively safe way for us to do it. And so, you know, we weren't the only ones who had that idea. You know, by the time we got up there and spent some time in the mountains, we discovered that quite a few other people had decided the same thing. So it was a little crowded, but still, it was better than doing some other things that we could have done on vacation. So that was something that we thought was a fairly typical experience. But the thing is that even before the pandemic was sort of restricting what we thought would be an appropriate vacation, getting up into the mountains, any mountain really, has always appealed to my spouse and I. It even includes Turkey Mountain. You all familiar with Turkey Mountain? It's not really a mountain, is it? I mean, it's really just a big hill that has a really exaggerated name. It thinks a lot of itself. But it's still a really great place to go and spend some time. I mean, you can go, they have great hiking trails, walking trails, and you can take your dog out there, and it's fun. So we like Turkey Mountain, even if it's not actually a mountain. But whether it's a hill or a mountain, there's always a chance when you do something like this that you'll experience what I've heard described as a thin place. So it's a place where you sense you are walking in two worlds at once. And that's happened to me on more than a couple of occasions when traveling in the mountains. And this also shows up in the Bible too. There are many places in the Bible where the spiritual world breaks into ours when folks are traveling up to the mountain. So I'm sure most of us are familiar with the story of Moses when he encounters the bush that is on fire but not being consumed. On another trip up the mountain, Moses receives God's commandments. Three of Jesus' disciples follow him up the mountain, and there they witness his transfiguration. You might remember the story of the transfiguration. And not only that, but while they're up on the mountain, they're engulfed in a cloud that booms with the voice of God. Now, one of the most well-known parts of Matthew's gospel is the Sermon on the Mount, which takes place where? On a mountain, exactly. So the Sermon on the Mount, and today we get Luke's version of part of that same sermon. We get Luke's version of the Beatitudes. So the Sermon on the Mount starts with the Beatitudes, and so does Luke's version of that same story. So as a rule of thumb, when we hear scripture that has a mountain in it, that's a clue to pay attention, because God is breaking into our world in a way that we are supposed to notice. Now, for every rule of thumb, there's also an exception, and I think today we also get an exception, although it's one that sort of proves the point. In today's gospel, Jesus doesn't just give the Beatitudes, he actually comes down from the mountain in order to preach them. So why? Why would he not just stay up top? Why did he come down from the mountain to do that? Well, it's not because Luke thinks the mountain's unimportant or that nothing happens up there that we should be paying attention to. It just plays a different role for him, right? So in Luke, Jesus goes up to the mountain and treats it as a place of intimacy. It's a place of solitude. It's a place where he meets privately with his disciples, his apostles, the 12 apostles. And it's also a place where he prays. Sometimes he spends all night praying to God on the mountain. Now, when he's ready to talk with lots and lots of people, that's when he comes down. That's when he descends. He comes down from the mountain, and there he finds lots of people that are ready to listen to his sermon on the plain. Now, his apostles are there, the 12 apostles, but there's also a great crowd of other disciples, and there's a great multitude of other people from far and wide. So what happens on the mountain is important, but what's happening on the plain is important too, because that's where we're going to hear the Beatitudes, and it includes a lot more people. There's a lot more people for him to speak to down there. The apostles may have shared the mountaintop with Jesus, but down on the plain, everyone shares in Jesus' message. As Father Lee is fond of saying, Luke's vision is that of the great meeting hall where everyone is invited to the banquet. Still, what Jesus is about to say is meant for people who follow him. It's meant for people who would consider themselves disciples. Then he looked upon his disciples and said. Then he looked upon his disciples and said. And here by disciples, we're talking about anyone who's become a follower of Jesus. And that would include other followers at the time beyond the apostles. And it also includes us. It includes anyone who thinks of themselves as a follower of Jesus. And again, this isn't any kind of exclusion. It's not supposed to leave anybody out. It's simply a way for Jesus to say, this is how things actually are. He's saying, if you are my follower, I'm about to say some things that you already know are true. I'm about to say some things that are already part of your reality. And if you wish to be my follower, here are some things that you are going to discover to be true. These are things you will learn. In the Beatitudes, Jesus is simply stating how life is, both inside and outside the kingdom. And the thing about the kingdom of God is that while it may have been initiated by Jesus, it was just a beginning. It didn't complete during his lifetime, and I don't think we can claim it's been completed in our lifetime either. Still, if we want to think about the difference between the vision and the reality of the kingdom of God, let's just think a little bit about the poverty that existed at Jesus' time. 68% of the people Jesus would have encountered were either at risk of being or were already below basic subsistence levels necessary for life. 68%. Another 22% had just enough to reliably survive. Just enough, but they were just barely there. So that's 90% of the population. 9 out of every 10 people Jesus would have encountered were either at the edge of or below where they needed to be in order to live. So when Jesus says, blessed are you who are poor, he's talking about almost everyone. Almost everyone he met would have fit that category. When Jesus says, blessed are you who are hungry now, he's speaking to the people right there. The people that are listening to his sermon, because he knows many of them are, in fact, hungry. When he says, blessed are you who weep now, he's talking to people who have plenty of reasons to expect that things are not going to get any better anytime soon. When he says, blessed are you when people hate you, or when they exclude you, or revile you, or defame you, he's frankly admitting what he expects to happen to people who follow him. And he's even foreshadowing what will happen to him. So exactly how are these people considered blessed? I mean, what's going on with that? Well, it might be helpful to remember that the word we translate as blessed can also mean lucky. It can also mean rich. Or maybe that doesn't help us. Maybe that just furthers the complication that we're thinking about here. So again, how are poor, hungry, despairing, and despised people lucky? In what way are they rich? Well, again, it's important for us to remember that the conditions Jesus describes applies to almost everyone in his society, whether they are Jew or Gentile. And what he's saying to every single one of them is that they all matter to God. They haven't been forgotten. Jesus reassures them, gives them hope that God knows who they are, that God has a kingdom just for them, that God wants them to be filled with good things, and that God will give them reasons to laugh and to rejoice and to leap for joy. In fact, it's already begun. The kingdom has arrived. Jesus' followers already know this. Those who want to follow him will learn it. And then there's us. What are we to make of the Beatitudes, words spoken by Jesus in a world where 4 out of every 10 people did not have enough to live, where 3 out of every 10 could drop into that category at any time, and where only 2 out of 10 were barely staying above the line? Well, the first thing we can understand is that his followers, that is, Jesus' followers, saw him as more than a teacher of moral values. He wasn't just someone providing an example of how to live a compassionate life in difficult times. He did do that. But when he gives his full attention to the pain of others, which he did, when he comforts them, which he did, when he cares for them, which he did, when he heals them and when he loves them, which he did, it was more than just modeling a life that other people can copy. It wasn't just a humanitarian exercise. It was God. It was God being revealed in Christ. It was a way for people to understand what God wants to provide them. It was a way for them to understand that God sees them, cares for them, loves them. It's like what happens up on the mountain. The mountain isn't just a place to take a hike, although it's that. It's also a place where we can have encounters with God. The mountain can show us something about how God is present or breaking into the world. And we take that with us even when we come off the mountain. It's a place that can open us up. Now, I've had folks ask me before about the kingdom of God. They've basically said, what exactly is it? You know, they hear about it in the scriptures, but it's usually just described in terms of metaphors when it's described in the scriptures at all. It's not always straightforward what's meant. But I think when the kingdom happens, it happens when we walk with Jesus. When we read, Jesus looked up at his disciples and said, we can safely assume he's also talking to us. When Jesus says, feed the hungry and bring hope to the hopeless, he means it. We can be sure of that. But as important as that may be, if we just focus on that, if we just focus on outcomes, I think we might miss the point. The disciples in today's gospel are physically with Jesus. He talks to them, he teaches them, he walks with them, he eats with them. But you get a sense that just being with Jesus is an important part. When we spend time with Jesus, when we walk his paths, whether we're teaching or speaking or praying or eating, something opens up in us as well. And we don't have to say, quote, I want to feed the hungry or I want to console the despairing, because Jesus, as a good moral teacher, taught me that in the Beatitudes. We can do it because by being with Jesus, we have been opened up to this world. And this world is a place that desperately needs the kingdom to have opened up in it. We become the thin place. We become the thin place. Yes, it's feeding the hungry and consoling the despairing, but it's also simply being. Being with Jesus, who is making the kingdom happen in us. Amen.
We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is, seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshiped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Let us pray for the whole state of Christ's church and the world. Almighty and ever-living God, who in thy holy word has taught us to make prayers and supplications and to give thanks for all men, receive these our prayers which we offer unto thy divine majesty, beseeching thee to inspire continually the universal church with the spirit of truth, unity, and concord, and grant that those who do confess thy holy name may agree in the truth of thy holy word and live in unity and godly love. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Give grace, O Heavenly Father, to all bishops and other ministers, especially Justin, the Archbishop of Canterbury, Michael, our presiding bishop, pollution on our own bishop, that they may both, by their life and doctrine, set forth thy true and lively word, and rightly and duly administer the holy sacraments. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And to thy people, give the heavenly grace, and especially to this congregation here present, that with meek heart and due reverence, they may hear and receive the holy word, truly serving thee in holiness and righteousness all the days of their life. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We beseech thee also to rule the hearts of those who bear the authority of government in this and every land. We pray for Joseph, our president, Kevin, our governor, GT, our mayor, that we may be led to wise decisions and right actions for the welfare and peace of the world. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Open, O Lord, the eyes of all the people to behold thy gracious hand in all thy works, that rejoicing in thy whole creation, they may honor thee with the substance and be faithful stewards of thy bounty. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And we most humbly beseech thee of thy goodness, O Lord, to comfort and succor Barbara, Sue, Odell, Nancy, Paulette, Alicia, Jeremy, Marjorie, Shirley, Taylor, Cameron, Finley, David, Brandy, the Reese family, Barbara, Heidi, Mary, Vivian, Laura, Carlina, Barbara, Rayma, Cindy, Christy, Leo, Elliot, Eileen, Theodore, Sylvia, and all that are suffering from COVID, Jay, Mary, Philippe, and Brian, and those who in this transitory life are in trouble, sorrow, need of sickness, or any adversity, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We also bless thy holy name for all thy servants departed this life in thy faith and fear, especially beseeching thee to grant them continual growth with thy love and service, and to grant us grace to follow the good examples of and of all the saints, that we may be partakers of thy heavenly kingdom. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Grant these our prayers, O Father, for Jesus Christ's sake, our only mediator and advocate. Amen.
Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who of his great mercy hath promised forgiveness of sins to all those who with hearty repentance and true faith turn unto him, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and bring you to everlasting life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Please stand as you are able. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Please be seated for a few brief announcements. Well, if you are new to Trinity, welcome. Please fill out the red books or the maroon books in the pews on the aisle side of the pews. If you'd like a name tag, there is a sign-up list out on the table in the Great Hall. And if you sign in on our book outside in the, before you come into the nave in the narthex, we'll send you a thank you for being here. Today is our Super Bowl chili fundraiser benefiting our youth. If you have not ordered, there might still be some chili left out there. Otherwise, pick up what you've ordered. Today is this evening at 5 p.m. And on Friday, the Tulsa Chorale will present a concert here at 7 p.m. in memory of those who have died from COVID, and the concert is free. We have a diocesan vocation workshop coming up the end of the month on the 22nd. If you are feeling called to any type of ordained ministry or any ministry, talk to Father Lee, Father Chris, or myself, and we will sign you up with the right path for that. You may have noticed that Deacon Linda is back, so our welcome to Deacon Linda. She's back in our folds, and we'll be seeing her on whatever Wednesdays that she, or Sundays that she's here. Walk in love, as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God.
Thank you. us give thanks unto our Lord God. It is very meet, right, and our bounden duty that we should at all times and in all places give thanks unto thee, O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty, everlasting God, because in the mystery of the Word made flesh, thou hast caused a new light to shine in our hearts, to give the knowledge of the glory in the last face of Jesus. Thou hast caused a new light to shine in our hearts, to give the knowledge of the glory in the face of our Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify thy glorious name, evermore praising thee and saying,
glory be to thee, O Lord our God, for that thou didst create heaven and earth, and didst make us in thine own image, and of thy tender mercy didst give thine only Son, Jesus Christ, to take our nature upon him, and to suffer death upon the cross for our redemption. He made there a full and perfect sacrifice for the whole world, and did institute and in his holy gospel command us to continue a perpetual memory of that his precious death and sacrifice until his coming again. For in the night in which he was betrayed, he took bread, and when he had given thanks to thee, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Likewise, after supper, he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you, for this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the remission of sins. Do this as oft as ye shall drink it in remembrance of me." Wherefore, O Lord and Heavenly Father, we thy people do celebrate and make with these holy gifts, which we now offer unto thee, the memorial thy Son hath commanded us to make, having in remembrance his blessed passion and precious death, his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and looking for his coming again with power and great glory. And we humbly, most humbly beseech thee, O merciful Father, to hear us and with thy word and Holy Spirit, to bless and sanctify these gifts of bread and wine, that they may be unto us the body and blood of thy dearly beloved Son, Jesus Christ. And we earnestly desire thy fatherly goodness to accept this our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, whereby we offer and present unto thee, O Lord, ourselves, our souls, and bodies. Grant, we beseech thee, that all who partake of this holy communion may worthily receive the most precious body and blood of thy Son, Jesus Christ, and be filled with thy grace and heavenly benediction, and also that we and thy whole church may be made one body in him, that he may dwell in us and we in him, through the same Jesus Christ, our Lord. By whom and with whom and in whom Jesus, I believe that you are truly present in the holy sacrament of the altar. I love you above all things and long for you in my soul. Since I cannot now receive you sacramentally, come at least spiritually into my heart. I embrace you and unite myself entirely to you. Let me never be separated from you. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ had taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us. We do not presume to come to this thy table, O merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in thy manifold and great mercies, we are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under thy table. But thou art the same Lord whose property is always to have mercy. Grant us, therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of thy dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that we may evermore dwell in him and he in us. Amen. The gifts of God for the people of God.
Thank you.
Our post-communion prayer. Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, we most heartily thank thee for that thou dost feed us in these holy mysteries with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of thy Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and dost assure us thereby of thy favor and goodness towards us, that we are very members incorporate in the mystical body of thy Son, the blessed company of all faithful people, and are also heirs through hope of thy everlasting kingdom. And we humbly beseech thee, O Heavenly Father, so to assist us with thy grace, that we may continue in that holy fellowship and do all such good works as thou hast prepared for us to walk in, through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with thee and the Holy Ghost be all honor and glory, world without end. Amen. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you forever.
Let us go forth in the name of Christ.